The third episode of IT Idiots. My name is Nicholas Hill, and I'm joined as usual by our resident IT expert and trainer, Nikki Curtis.
Hi.
In this week's show, we're going to be looking at multiple DCs, sites, and replication. So let's just have a little bit of a chat and catch up a little bit as to what we've been up to this week. So what have you been up to this week, Nikki?
Me? Well, 4-day working week, of course, because of Easter.
Very nice.
Yeah, started on Tuesday, did a bit of documentation from home, so that was kind of nice.
Sweet little intro into the week there. Slide you neatly into a working week.
And other than that, I've been doing an SMS installation in just outside of Surrey, and just checking back on a weekly basis just to check on stability of that to make sure everything's going okay. So just checking
good.
On that. And also starting an Active Directory design a company that's about 20,000 users, so that's going to be quite exciting.
Sounds a bit daunting to me, but I'm sure to you it's just everyday stride.
Bring it on.
Everyday stride. That sounds pretty good. Well, my time's really been taken up with trying to get the website up and running. It was pretty sweet, actually.
They got some nice comments from the website, actually.
I saw that. That was pretty good. And we built that using Joomla, and that took about... It took about half a day, actually, dude, to put it all together and get it all up and running. I was really, really pleased with that. It was my first installation of Joomla. I've played around with it a bit. I've got a couple of other projects sort of in the pipeline for Joomla, but that was my first go live.
No, I mean, quite a few people have commented on the website and how good it is. And I mean, I didn't have anything to do with it. Nick did it all himself. So it must have been easy. But they're quite impressed with how quick it was to set up. And I think we ought to do a podcast maybe on that.
Yeah, I think so.
That sounds be interesting to knock up a website so quickly.
I think there's definitely some scope there for showing maybe smaller and medium-sized businesses how to get a good commercial presence up and running. So yeah, maybe we'll
totally open source as well.
We'll give that a bit of thought. And the other thing I've been working on, which I really think you guys have probably been waiting out for, and that is we've finally sussed how we're going to encode and do this show so that we've got a good quality format, sound, improving the sound, and really just making the whole thing a bit more watchable when people are chilled out on the sofa.
Cool.
Or at work during your lunch hour, I hope, because from what I've heard, your big brother company could be watching you. So bring it on. So
thanks for the feedback, guys. It's been really interesting reading them, but just keep on bringing it on to feedback@itidiots.com.
Yeah.
That's really cool.
I think we should probably cover why Shabby's not with us this week. It's got nothing to do with the fact that he felt out of his depth. It's work. He had work commitments, which has sadly not allowed him to be with us this week. But we feel that we should be able to cover in his absence.
But he might show up. You never know.
You never know. So stay tuned. Could be a little surprise for you.
Metroid Prime. Good game. Finally released on the DS. You had a look at it.
I did. I had
a look. Nick's a bit of a PSP guy. He doesn't seem to understand games play versus graphic. Anyway, I suppose we better crack on, haven't we?
I think so. Yeah. So I was wondering if you might be able to just give us a quick recap as to what we did last week.
Last week what we did is the first week we introduced the concept of domains and work groups, and last week we started building the IT Idiots infrastructure. And we did that by setting up a domain controller, which is the one you're looking at right now. So let's just remind ourselves of what we actually did by just logging onto this domain controller, the IT Idiots domain. It's saying, why did it shut down unexpectedly? And that's because
you pulled
the USB drive out, didn't you?
Small technical setup while setting up. So whilst he reboots that, I just want to make one small little point, and that is that we didn't seem to get any sponsorship from the big coffee company from the past couple of weeks, so we've moved over to traditional English tea. What tea are you actually drinking this week, Nikki?
I think it's Darjeeling.
Oh, okay, mine's a Lapsang Souchong, or something like that.
Okay, so back to this domain controller. The first thing I'm going to do is just like Active Directory users and computers, I don't know if you recall that at all. It was it's like an interface on Active Directory, and it lets us see the objects in it. And one of the objects we, or a few of the objects we talked about last week, were users, groups, and computers. So let's
just
remind ourselves on what we actually did. So up pops Active Directory users and computers, and what we did last week is we started defining our IT infrastructure, and we mentioned that we've got three locations: one in Ashford, that's where Nick is; one in Surbiton, which is here; and one in Dudley, which is where Shabby originally comes from.
That's we closed down the Dudley branch. That's why Shabby's not with us secretly.
Yeah. So as he's not here, I think what's often good practice is to actually disable his account.
We covered that last week.
So let's just disable his account. Okay. And now the other things we did, we set up an OU structure to contain the actual client machines.
Mm-hmm.
And we divided them into the operating system type. So we've got Windows 2000, Windows NT, and Windows XP. So that's the basic domain infrastructure in place. So the IT Idiots Network's well underway. Now, what we're going to do this week is we're going to add an additional domain controller to the actual IT Idiots Network. And we can start off that. What I've done is a little bit of preparation by going to the second machine. Now, this second machine is just Windows 2003 server. It's just been installed in Service Pack, nothing else. So it's actually in a work group at the moment.
So what we're looking at actually doing here is obviously having more than one DC.
Yep.
So what would be the benefits of having more than one DC?
Well, good question. Yeah, more than one DC, there's a number of reasons why you have more than one DC. I suppose the most obvious one is fault tolerance.
Okay, yeah, makes sense.
At the moment, our IT Idiot Network is not very fault tolerant, in that if we lose the machine, the domain controller we installed last week, that's it. We've lost our account database, we lost the domain. So what we're going to do now is install our second one to increase fault tolerance.
Mm-hmm. Sounds a good idea.
Also, because our corporate infrastructure is based in those three locations, another reason for having multiple domain controllers is one of accessibility.
Okay.
So when you're logging in at Ashford, at the moment when you log in at Ashford, your authentication is actually going across a wide area network onto the domain controller in Surbiton.
Yeah.
Okay. So what we want to do is actually place a domain controller in Ashford so that users can be locally authenticated without establishing any WAN-link traffic. So this one was another USB drive problem. Let's just ignore that one. Okay, now just as we saw last week, to actually install a domain controller, we need to just run a program called DC Promo. Now DC Promo also demotes a domain controller into a member server, as they're called. So I'm just going to run DC
Promo. I think you've got your...
I've got number lock on.
I think you have, yeah.
Okay. So up it pops. Now I suppose the important things we need to talk about here is I'm going to join the itidiots.com domain. Now, it's important that, you know, that this machine could find that domain so it can actually join us. So I can't ask Shabby, can I? So I have to ask you.
Yeah.
How's it going to actually find the domain controllers?
I'm thinking something, maybe DNS?
Exactly right. So DNS. Okay. So we'll come back to DNS as we go through the actual DC Promo process. So up on the screen now, it's asking me, what role is this domain controller going to be? Is it going to be a domain controller for a new domain?
Nah.
Is it going to be an additional domain controller for an existing domain? And, of course, that is true.
Bing!
So I click on Next on that one. It's now asking me for a user account who's got permissions to install Active Directory on this computer.
So that's going to be our administrator.
Yeah, it's going to be an administrator.
But it's going to have to be an administrator, surely, from our... No, it can be a local administrator, couldn't it?
Yep, it can be a local administrator of this machine, yeah.
Okay.
Admin straightor. Have I spelled that wrong?
Yeah, I think so. We've got an administrator.
Administrator is one of my favourite ones. Oh, actually, you know what? I was incorrect. We're adding an additional domain controller, aren't we? So we're adding an additional domain controller for the domain, so we need permissions on the domain.
Yes.
In order to create a domain controller, your first one, like last week, we'd need to be a local administrator.
Okay.
So my mistake, but you didn't pay anything. Right. So what I'm going to do now is it's asking me what domain I want to join. And funnily enough, when I click on Browse, it can find the domain. And that's because it's done a query in Active Directory. It's done a query in DNS.
DNS.
So let's join the adidiots.com domain. click on next, just the location of the database files, so the database and the log files. Again, we talked about that last week, so I'm just going to press on with that. Remember, it's just got to be NTF. This location, the sysfile, has got to be on an NTFS drive. Mm-hmm. The sysfile is the location that stores your group policies and also your logon scripts.
I think we covered that a little bit last week, didn't we?
A little bit last week, but again, we will have a group policy episode where we'll delve down into that.
Go into it a bit more detail.
Okay, now the restore mode password. Should this domain controller suffer any kind of problems with the account database, we're going to want to, you know, restore from a backup, possibly. Or, you know, in reality, what I would tend to do is actually just DC premit this thing down and DC premit back up again.
It makes, yeah.
You know, because if you DC premit it down and up again, it's going to re-replicate all the information from the first domain controller, ITI DMC01.
Okay.
Okay, which is going to be a lot more up-to-date than your backup.
Exactly, that makes a lot more sense, doesn't it?
But, hey,
we'll set it up.
They might all go wrong. So if Active Directory, there is a problem with it and we need to actually restore it in order to get onto this machine because AD's down, we can log on using this restore password, restore mode password. Right, click on next. And again, it's just telling me exactly, just a little review of the locations of the database and also the sysfile.
So that's now basically installing. We're running DC promo. I had a quick question for you. So can you actually use a non-Microsoft DNS server?
Yeah, good question, actually. Let's just go back to the first domain controller, the one we worked on last. Ignore that. Go away.
I'm sure we're up to date. I'm sure we're safe.
There was actually a software update. You're probably aware that Microsoft do software updates on the second Tuesday of every month. Mm-hmm. And there's actually a software update this month that undid a software update of the last month.
Oh, I wasn't aware of that. Oh, okay.
That was
so
kind of amusing.
They've backtracked.
They've done a little bit of backtracking. And I found that. Don't want to read that. Dig, probably. Okay, what was I doing? DNS. We're looking at DNS. So if I just go into my admin tools and go into DNS here, down the bottom. Now, this is our Microsoft DNS server. It's fully compatible with standard DNS as well, and that's what we refer to as bind DNS.
Okay.
Barclays Internet Naming Daemon is what it stands for. Barclays in the place in America. And at the moment, the question was, can we use a non-Microsoft DNS server? The answer is actually yes, you can. You can use most modern DNS servers. But bind version is the sort of fully, if you want full support on a non-Microsoft DNS server, you need to go for a bind version 8.2.1. is the minimal. Basically, what we're looking at is a DNS server that supports dynamic updates.
Okay.
Okay. Because I don't remember from last week, when I installed the first domain controller, we saw mystically all of these records appear in DNS.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, no, it did. It all just appeared at once, didn't it?
Now, look at all these entries. There's quite a lot of them. This is from one machine.
Mm-hmm.
So there's no way I want to statically configure that. So dynamic updates, we do need. Now, that is supported on non-Microsoft DNS servers. But the thing that isn't often is secure dynamic updates.
Okay.
Okay, now let's imagine we install a web server, www.itidiots.com.
Mm-hmm.
Now that's going to register in DNS as www.itidiots.com.
Yep.
Now, if that's a Microsoft DNS server that's allowing unsecure dynamic updates, then an intruder can install a web server and they can say, I'm going to call it www.itidiots.com.
So they're hijacking you.
Right. Yeah, in a way, and point to your DNS server, and they register over your record.
Yep.
And in effect, when people are trying to get to www.itidiots.com, they're going somewhere else.
Ah.
Perhaps a bit more entertaining, perhaps. I don't know. Yeah, it's a good question. But yeah, I would say, in most cases, certainly all the Active Directory networks I've been involved in and installed, we've always used Microsoft DNS.
Okay.
Definitely a strong recommendation for it.
Okay.
It will integrate with an existing infrastructure quite well as well. So that's just a little bit of DNS. Let's have a flip back to the domain controller to see what's going on now. So you can see a little graphic coming across showing us it's replicating across. Okay.
Yeah.
Shouldn't take too much longer now. What we're actually notice is as this DC promo is taking place, this will actually be dynamically registering the DNS server.
Mm-hmm.
So once this has actually taken place, we'll be able to have a look at the DNS server and see the new records.
Oh, okay.
Securing registry values, come on. And it will involve a reboot as well.
Okay, so...
Okay, so here we go. Let's just reboot this. So after the domain controller installation, there is a reboot involved. Now, when we go back to DNS, when this machine actually starts up, the net logon service should register the additional records in this DNS server, so we should be able to see them.
Okay.
However, that won't be there just yet. So what I can do is just pop into Active Directory Users and Computers, and did I click on it now? Yeah, here we go.
Yep.
And go to the Domain Controllers OU, and we can now see there's two domain controllers in there, or two machine accounts in there. We've got AshDMC01,
okay,
which is the Ashford DMC, domain controller, and ITIDMC01.
Mm-hmm.
And we talked about naming conventions last week as well. And our naming convention, we're using, you know, three characters to represent the location, mm-hmm, Ash for Ashford. Now, ITI is actually Surbiton, and I'm calling it ITI because it's the headquarters.
Headquarters.
It's the headquarters of the network. The second three letters are the role of the machine, so DMC.
Domain controller.
Yeah, lots of people use DC for that. I use DMC because I like to use fixed character lengths. So if it was a SQL server, it could be ITI SQL. You know, so you can normally fit most things into a three-character
sure
code. Now, this domain controller, Ashford, is just firing up now. It does take a little bit longer on the reboot after the initial domain controller installation.
Okay.
So I've just got to hang on for a little bit. Let's have some tea.
Okay, so let's have a little slurp of tea.
So how's your cake business? Oh, how's your cake business going, Nick?
Yeah, not so bad. Not so bad. We're busy making lots of cakes.
After you jumped out of the rat race.
No more city and no more commuting for me, sir. Life of poverty.
So I'm logging onto the domain now. It should be registering the DNS records as we speak. But the DNS records are actually registered when the NetLogon service starts.
Okay. So the DNS records...
Yep.
How did they get there?
That was because of the dynamic update process, okay. Yeah. So this is supporting dynamic updates. And let me just quickly show you the properties of this server. And I don't know exactly what tab. You know what I've done? I've actually gone to the wrong location. It's secure updates to this zone, ad.idedits.com.
Yeah.
And we can see we're accepting secure updates only.
Okay.
Which means you need to have a computer account in the domain in order to update DNS.
Okay, so we've seen that we've got an additional DC.
Mm-hmm.
I guess the question that I sort of would like to ask is, how does the... So we've got our studio audience again. How does Active Directory manage to maintain the consistency across these multiple domains controllers that we've now set up between Ashford and headquarters in Surbiton?
Yeah, good question. It's all to do with replication. Now, one thing you'll notice is you haven't seen me do anything to... Oh, I haven't done anything to these machines off camera. You've seen
no.
me do everything. Domain controller last week. I installed a domain controller this week, and they're going to replicate. I don't have to do anything because it's taken a number of assumptions.
Ah, okay.
Process. Now, what I can do is show you another tool called Active Directory Sites and Services.
Uh-huh.
Now, I'm not really interested in the services. I'm just interested in Active Directory Sites. So I'm going to ignore the services node, which incidentally doesn't show by default. So what we can see is I've got one site. Now, this one site's called Default First Site Name. Good name, eh?
Well, it's descriptive anyway.
It's the one site you always get on the creation of your initial domain. Now, ignore that. Now, when I have a look in that site, I can see I've got two servers inside that site.
Okay.
And they automatically went in there because it didn't know any better. I haven't configured anything else to say it should belong to another site. And I'll talk about that in just a second.
Okay.
So we can see those are actually in one site. They're going to replicate every 5 minutes. Okay, so within a site, things are replicating every 5 minutes, so there's only a latency between 5 minutes.
So at head office, if you were to create a new starter for the company, within 5 minutes, they can actually be working in Ashford?
Yeah, exactly right. So if we create a new user account on the domain controller in the headquarters, it will take 5 minutes to replicate, or a maximum 5 minutes to replicate across to Ashford, and therefore user logging on in Ashford can be locally authenticated by that DC. Okay.
And that's a pretty standard setup, is it? That we would set it up 5 minutes is a typical time, or would people change that to be a longer or shorter time?
Again, good question. Within a site, you can't control it. These things are going to replicate every 5 minutes.
Okay.
And that's it. Can't control it.
Okay, that's a fixed period of time.
Can't control within a site. And that's referred to as intra-site replication.
Okay.
But what you can do is you can control replication between sites, inter-site replication.
Inter-site. Okay.
So what I could do here... it's going to my site. Mm-hmm. And it's a little bit strange, this tool, because, well, I'll show you. Let me define a new site. And this is going to be a site for Ashford.
What permissions do you actually require, are required to actually create this site?
Bloody number lock. Okay. The permissions, it's a good question. The permissions required to create a site, you're actually, you know, you're affecting the whole infrastructure of creating a site. This could be multiple domains. So you've actually got to be higher up than a domain admin. And the one up from a domain admin is called an enterprise admin.
Okay, I wasn't aware of that.
To be honest, we haven't really talked about that as yet, but we will come on to that. So, where was I? New site. So the new site is going to be called Ash. Sorry, I'm not so with it today. As you can see, my number lock is on. Ashford. The next thing down the bottom, it's saying, well, how is this site going to be joined to the other site?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so we can't just have two sites and they're not going to replicate with one another. They've got to be joined. So there is a default site link called default site link or default IP site link.
Now, it's a bit of a giveaway. It was on the screen.
I've got to choose it. I can't not choose it.
Okay.
Because I happen to find any other site links. Okay. It's now saying you've created a new site. You should make sure there's a domain controller in that site.
Which we've already set up.
Yeah, but it's not in that site yet.
Ah, we haven't added it to the site.
No.
Okay.
Now, I just want to go through the actual properties of a site. So if you have a look at the properties of Ashford, we can see there's a subnet box in that.
Mm-hmm.
And you belong to a site if you fall within one of those subnets, one of those IP networks.
Okay.
So I'm actually going to make this up. I'm going to say we've got a subnet in Ashford, an IP subnet in Ashford, and the IP subnet is 192.168.8.0. Okay, so that's just the actual.
Mm-hmm.
And if your client machine or domain controller falls within that subnet,
it should be in Ashford. Okay.
Okay. Now, what this now means is if there was a client machine, mm-hmm. a client machine that falls within that subnet 192.168.8.0, mm-hmm. so in Ashford, when it logs on, it will actually try and find a domain controller in Ashford.
So it's going to go and look for the local domain controller before it then would try and go out and...
Before it goes anywhere else, yeah.
Yeah.
Exactly right. So at the moment, it's not a fine one because there isn't one in Ashford. So okay. It's just going to... It could authenticate to ITDMC01 or it could be to ASHDMC01. Obviously, we want it to go to ASHDMC01.
Yeah.
So what I can simply do is take ASHDMC01
and drag it into...
Just expand that and just drag it into that.
And it's as straightforward and as simple as that?
It is, yeah.
That's great.
Now, your client machines are actually dynamic.
Okay.
So if you've got a laptop machine, you go down to Ashford, you'll get an IP address from the Ashford Ashford subnet.
Of course.
So you'd automatically log on to that DC.
Yep.
If you were to bring your laptop to the headquarters, you'll get an IP address from the DHCP server here, so you'd automatically be authenticated by the DC.
So you're always going to your local domain controller.
Yeah. Now, domain controllers, they're not dynamic.
Okay.
Because you would generally move a domain controller around.
You generally don't put it in the back of the car and drag it to the end of the country. That's for sure.
Well, actually, you do a lot of the time. You do.
Really?
Yeah. Sometimes I work for a consultancy organisation, a consultancy company. So sometimes, or what we used to do is install domain controllers on, at our office and then ship them down.
But that's deployment.
Yeah, I suppose so, yeah.
That's deploying. You're not then going to pick it up and next week take it to another location.
No, that is very true. Okay, so in Ashford...
So you haven't outsourced that to China yet?
No. Hey, we might have Chinese, but no, we won't. Okay, so domain controllers. Now, I put that domain controller in that site just by dragging and dropping it.
Okay.
Now, in actual fact... What would have been a better idea would, if I actually set up the subnet
mm-hmm.
and set up the site prior to the creation of that domain controller,
yeah.
during the DC promo stage, it says, look at the sites, I fall within that subnet belongs to the Ashford site and it automatically slots in.
Okay.
But when I DC promoed it, that wasn't in place, that went into default first site.
Which is the headquarters.
Services. And as we said, domain controllers, they don't dynamically assess their site like your client machines. Okay, so that's Ashford and the headquarters set up as domain controllers.
Surbiton's in London, by the way. It's a wealthy commuter suburb of London, and only a few privileged people can afford to live there. Not me.
You're doing quite well if you live there. Why do I say these things, eh? Okay, so domain controller. Let's load up Active Directory domains and users and computers. And this is on the Ashford domain controller.
Okay.
So if I expand relocate, where did these come from? You know, so we can see these have
replicated. It's replicated. Well, we've gone more than 5 minutes. We've been talking for more than 5 minutes here, so.
Yeah, it's okay.
And I have to have done it.
And actually, fact, during the DC promo, it replicates at that stage.
Okay, so it goes and takes its initial snapshot
exactly
from...
Right.
Okay, well, it needs something, I guess, at starting point, so it might as well build it from Surbiton.
And we've made no changes either as well, so it hasn't needed to replicate. So, how long do things replicate within a site again?
Within a site?
Intra.
Intra?
Intranet. Within a site. It's 5 minutes, remember. 5 minutes, no control.
5 minutes, no control.
Yeah, no control within a site. Now, we're now in different sites. And we're actually, if I just go, sorry, to skip backwards and forwards like this, if I just load up Active Directory sites and services again, we can see that those two domain controllers we've got are in different sites. So how frequently do they replicate? Well, the answer to that is we've got total control of that. Now, remember what actually joins those two sites up? It's the default site link. So, it's based on IP. And there it is there, the default site link.
Okay.
Let's look at properties of the default site link. And we can see it's joining up Ashford and default first site name.
And it's replicating every 3 hours.
Replicating every 3 hours, yeah.
Okay. And obviously we've got the we can change.
We can change that. We can say replicate every hour, replicate every so often. Now, often in some networks, there's a period of activity overnight, maybe a across the wire backup or some kind of maintenance. So what we could say is, let's say at those 2 hours of the day, we're not going to replicate.
So we're taking it offline, basically.
We're taking it offline, yeah. So they're not going to replicate. So that just means that the network between Ashford and Surbiton is not going to be used for replication because it might be for something else. Okay, so every 3 hours. Now, let's just create a new user on the headquarters.
Just a quick question. When we create this, we're in Surbiton. We've got a new user who's starting with the company. Ashford's phoned you up, asked you if you can create it for whatever reason. There's no local administrator. You create them. I appreciate it's only 5 minutes, but can you actually force that replication at any time you want?
Is it 5 minutes? Remember, we're in different sites now.
Oh, we're in different sites.
Different sites, so it's every 3 hours, isn't it?
Every 3 hours, isn't it? So we've got 3 hours between those. Can we force that?
You can, yeah, you can force
okay.
it. Let's have a look at how we do that. The tool is Active Directory Sites and Services.
I don't want to be paying somebody in Ashford for 3 hours if they can't log on and actually do any work.
Right, so what I'm going to do is, underneath users, I'm just going to create a test user account.
Yeah, sure.
And let's say new user, and we call this one REPL test, replication test.
I thought it was some new fandangled name.
Right, I've got to give it a password. And we went through this last week, so I'm going to scoot through this one.
Yeah.
So, REPL test is in the user's container, and this machine is Ashford.
Yep.
Sorry, no, this machine is the headquarters.
Headquarters.
So, let's flick to Ashford now. So, this is the machine at Ashford. And when I go into users here, and do F5...
Where's our user?
It's replicated.
It's replicated.
Okay, amazing. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm just going to check to make sure that this was connected to the Ashford domain controller. Because sometimes what happens is, even though I'm sitting on Ashford, it might have connected across to the IT Idiots one. And I'm going to say Ashford.
Yep.
And let's just pop into users underneath here.
Is that a typical thing that quite often when people are setting these up, they forget to do this and...
It sometimes happens. Now, in actual fact, it's a lot to do with the setup.
Okay.
Because what happened is this client machine, it's IP, because remember it's a client machine as well as a server.
Yeah, of course.
I'm using it as a client, Its IP address is 192.168.5, which does not belong to Ashford, so it's going to choose a domain controller in its own site, which is the headquarters.
Yeah.
So if that machine really was in Ashford, it would have chosen the Ashford.
Yeah. Okay.
So we can see quite clearly there.
You mean it's not in Ashford? We haven't deployed it yet.
We haven't deployed it yet.
He ruined the link.
Right, so back to headquarters. There's record test. Back to Ashford. Not there. F5. So,
that's still not there.
Let's have a cup of tea and wait 3 hours.
What about... my tea's actually cold, so
My tea's not.
Can we maybe have a go at forcing that?
Let's force it. So, up-to-date Active Directory sites and services again. Now, when I go into Ashford, this is the Ashford site, so I can see the Ashford domain controller. And if I double-click on Ashford, I see NTDS, NT Directory Services settings. And underneath here, it will show me its replication partners. Now, at the moment, Ashford doesn't have any replication partners, so it's just part of the setup at the moment. I'm going to have a look at the default first site name, have a look at servers here, look at ITDMC, and see if it's worked from the other way around. So we can see it's worked one way, but it hasn't actually worked the other way.
It's not two-way at the moment. Yeah.
Not at the moment, no.
Okay.
Now, the way you actually replicate, this is pool replication.
Okay.
So I've gone to the headquarters domain controller, and this is telling me it can replicate, its replication partner is Ashford.
Okay, but in the pool we haven't got
that one yet, no. So if I do a right click and replicate now there, it's not going to help us, but just prove the point really, that's going to pull from Ashford onto the headquarters. ITIDMC.
But obviously we've created everything at headquarters and not at Ashford, but it can prove a point,
doesn't
it?
That's right. Sometimes it does take a little while to come across. I'm going to refresh. There is another option. I could create a manual one to speed things up. But I think what I'm going to do...
That's not a problem. Let's
do it the other way around.
Yeah, I think so. It's definitely.
So let's create a user account. Let's call this REPL Ash Test.
Well, yeah, I mean, we've got somebody who's just started in Ashford. They're actually on their way up to London and need to be able to log in. So let's get it so they can log in on the local London domain.
Oh, remember, it's the same domain,
the controller in London.
Okay, so this is now created in Ashford.
Okay.
Let's go to headquarters. Leave that tool open. If I go down to users here, let's refresh at this point. F5. We can see nothing that, there's no Ashford test in that. Or rep or Ash test. Let's go into Active Directory sites and services. Now, this is the way I think about it. I say, you go to the machine that's out of date, and you pull from the machine that's got the most up-to-date information.
Yep.
So the headquarters is out of date, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
So we go to that machine, and we go right-click on that, replicate now.
And it's as simple and straightforward as that?
As simple as that. It's just saying that it's replicating across different sites. Popping back into Active Directory user computers, if I now go into users and hit the refresh, I'm not quite sure what's going on in this tool. I keep on losing the refresh at the top. Notice that?
Yeah.
Okay, and do a refresh, we can now see
our Ashford user
Ashford test is in there. So we can port a replication. Now that would have happened within 3 hours. Or if it was within a site, that would have happened in around 5 minutes.
Sounds pretty good to me.
Okay, what I'm going to do is I'm just going to flick back to Ashford and just see if we've got a replication partner here as yet. Okay, so we can see that IT headquarters has popped in.
Mm-hmm.
Let's right-click on here and say replicate now. Okay, so that's pulled information from the headquarters domain controller onto Ashford.
Okay.
Go to Ashford, go to users, notice there's no REPL test there.
No.
Let's do a refresh.
You've lost your refresh again.
How weird.
Yeah, that's strange.
And we can now see that REPL test is in there.
That must have been part of the Microsoft's update.
Yeah, perhaps. Yeah, because I had inserted it.
Microsoft have fixed the refresh.
Okay, so that pretty much talks about installing a domain controller. So what you've seen us do, they added a domain controller to the ITDS domain. We've had a look at how they replicate with one another. We've noticed that within a site, they can replicate every 5 minutes.
That's brilliant.
Between sites, we have ultimate control.
Yeah.
Okay, so if you've got slow WAN links between sites, you might want to, you know, have more control on the network traffic between them. Maybe it's like a little modem link or a dial-up link between Ashford and Surbiton.
We've also seen that we can disable that and take it out of the loop at any given time if we want to, certainly for during updates or other things going on.
Yep. So we can say, don't replicate at 10 o'clock at night.
And we've seen that we...
BitTorrenting stuff.
And we've seen that I can force replication. Which sounds pretty good. So that's pretty good.
Yeah, so that sort of concludes this lesson. And what we're really doing is we're building the IT Idiots infrastructure. And the next thing we're going to look at is probably the most requested things from the feedback. And
it's got to be.
As I said, we've had quite a lot of nice feedback. And we opened it up pretty much and said, look, guys, we'll do anything you want.
And I've got to say thank you so much for the suggestions. We've taken it all on board.
Some of them. We've taken it all on board, and we tried to make the background a bit more exciting.
We're gonna make the cut twos a bit more punchier.
Systems management server.
It's got to be, hasn't it? It's the one big one that everyone wants to know more on. I don't think we're going to be able to do that in one lesson, though, my friend.
No, not at all. I think the way we're going to deal with that is next week we're going to have a look at an overview to find out what this actual product does, systems management server.
And then we'll, I guess, work out the best way to... I mean, there are the four key areas, whether we break those down into one per episode. I don't know yet. We'll figure it out.
See very much how, guys. Again, remember, you've got control of this, really.
So you tell us.
You tell us. You know, if you get bored of it, tell us, and we'll do something else.
Now, I guess on a lighter note, perhaps a more serious note, I've got medical issues this week, but we've got no pharmacist to give us advice. So
you have, haven't you?
Well, I've always got those medical issues, dude. But I think I'm going to probably have to hold those back, and I'm just going to be in more agony and discomfort for a week or two, hopefully just a week. But Shabby should hopefully be back next week. We'll see. But I guess that probably wraps up this week's show.
Yeah, another bit of feedback we got back from you was the episode was too long, which, you know, I was quite distraught about at first. I thought you can...
He's got a huge ego, guys. I mean, his original ideas here were to make them 3 or 4 hours. He was going to make German operas look short. So we've tried to cut this episode down, and again, give us your feedback. If you felt that we've skimmed over this too quickly, tell us. If you felt that the timing was right, tell us. We want to make this show what you guys want. I mean, that's what it's all about. This guy's got the knowledge. As I say, I've got a video camera, so that's why I'm still in it.
And you can edit as well.
And I can edit it. But do give us your continue to give us your feedback and tell us what you want us to do. But otherwise, I think that wraps up another great episode.
Okay.
Thank you, Nicky.
Okay, thank you.
Bye.
Himself to sleep tonight on his huge pillow.